Bet you didn't think you'd see me up here today. We rarely announce that Pastor Steve's not going to be here, and this week was no different. And strangely enough, it is Christ the King Sunday. Does anybody know what that is? Christ the King Sunday. It's the Sunday right before Advent. It's the last Sunday in regular time. It's the day, it actually was a feast that started in the early 1920s. It was called the Feast of Our Lord Jesus Christ the King, and it was celebrated on the last Sunday before Advent. Well, today is the last day before Advent. It literally means, Advent means the coming or arrival of our King. During this entire season coming up, just to kind of give you a little preview of what Pastor Steve's going to be doing in the next coming weeks, we celebrate the arrival of King and really three things are very true. We celebrate the birth of Jesus. We celebrate the fact that Jesus is not only born, died, and resurrected, but he's in the world today. He's active and seeking people out in this world today. And one day, he's going to return for us in power. Those are the things we celebrate, because those are absolutely true. During the 20s, when this feast came about, there was a few things going on. If you know your history, you remember in the Roaring 20s, there was a lot of stuff going on in this country that really hadn't happened before. We were seeing productivity and you know, big business was booming. The stock market was way up. And people were kind of forgetting who their king was. Even Christians, even people at church were starting to doubt the authority and even the existence of Jesus Christ. Well, this feast was designed to kind of remind the church that this is that who our King is, that we should have him in our lives every day, that we should live lives like he's on the inside of us. But I'll tell you, today, we've already feasted in a couple of different ways. We feasted on worship, surely. The Spirit is present in this room and in his place already. We're about to feast on his word. We have been given each other to have the feast with, and today, we're always given the ability to pray. And I say we don't really need a feast or a day to be set aside for the Lord when we have this opportunity to feast on the things that he's given us every single day. So good morning, and I want to welcome you to Christ the King Sunday. In that sense of community, I want to welcome you. Because we're privileged to have the King that we have. Amen? Amen. Oh, David, you unmuted the congregation. Thanks, brother. So what we're going to talk about today is no ordinary king. I mean, you usually don't have to look very far to find a king. Not these days. When I think king, at least these days, I think bling. You know, because kings these days, they kind of know how to make an entrance. You know, they got fancy limousines and they step out. They're all dressed nice and they got gold, silver, jewelry. Everything they have, it says about them that they're king. And of course, they have an entourage. You know, king's got to have people, right? Some people call them peeps. You know, like when I grew up, we called them lackeys. Or what's some other names for them? You can talk back. It's okay. I prefer it. A lackey, somebody, a henchman, maybe something like that. People call them. But anyways, you got to have entourage. You got to have somebody to do your bidding for you. Takes care of you, cleans up your messes, you know, covers it up when you didn't inhale or stuff like that. You guys remember that, right? Somebody goes around and covers that stuff up. But there's one thing I know about an entourage and somebody that follows somebody like that is they're not very loyal. And as soon as the king is in jeopardy of losing his power, what happens? Boom, entourage is gone and the king's left by himself. And you know the reason they do that, there's only one reason to do that, is because they know the king better than anybody else, right? They know that as soon as the king has the opportunity, he's going to do the exact same thing to them, right? Because, you know, they're going to abandon him. Kings these days are easy to find but hard to get to, right? They really are. I mean, you got to make an appointment. You got to jump through hoops to just to get maybe 30 seconds with the king. And I kind of imagine, this is kind of how I imagine you going before the king. You know, you dressed just a certain way, you have to walk a certain way, you have to talk a certain way. I kind of imagine in my head, like with a British accent, you know, because that's what I'm thinking, you know, a king to me sitting on a throne. And even maybe that, you know, that wig that they wear in the British Parliament, you know, that white wig. I wonder what that looks like. Oh, that's what it looks like over there. Look, Pastor Steve's wearing a wig. I wonder how that got up there. Couldn't resist. That's not really why I'm here this morning, to make fun of Pastor Steve, although I did take the opportunity, didn't I? So, I'm here to tell you that Jesus is no ordinary king. He's a gracious king. He is not the kind of king that would fight fire with fire, but he only fought fire with grace. And from the moment he stepped onto the scene in history, in every single way, in every single place in between, that's right, I'm going to rhyme today, he proved it over and over. He was certainly not a shallow king, and he didn't have gold and jewelry and all this, and entourage and all this stuff that you see with kings today. He certainly was the kind of king that would not abandon anyone. Now this morning we're going to kind of run through quickly leading up to our scripture, which is Luke 23, 32. We're going to start with the triumphal entry, where people were shouting, "Hosanna." And you'd think it kind of sounds like a king's entry. And if you looked at it without reading any further, you would say, all right, that's how a king enters. You know, people are shouting, "Hosanna," throwing down their cloaks, all that stuff. But if you remember the story, Jesus really didn't arrive exactly like a king would. Because a king would arrive in a stretch limo or a stretch camel or whatever. He'd have security guards. He'd be dressed to the nines, whatever that means. I really don't know. But not Jesus. He arrived in a manner befitting his purpose, which his purpose was to serve. Now, Jesus was truly a king, but he arrived on a borrowed donkey that had never been ridden before. There was no limo, nothing like that. He was a king who was approachable to old and young people alike. And you can be sure when he came rolling in, there was no commotion because of he was making a grand entrance. Because he came to serve and not be served. He was no ordinary king. He was a gracious king, a king who came to not fight fire with fire, but fight fire with grace. And from the moment he stepped on the scene, and every single place in between, he proved it over and over. He did not arrive like an ordinary king. Moving on to the Last Supper. Jesus simply asked us to remember him. Kings today have these images all painted of them. You know, they have these big, huge murals painted of this mighty king with a spear in their hand. Or they've got this big bust carved of them, of the king's image. And all their money. Oh, you love to put the king's image on money, because what do kings like more than taxes? Just about nothing, right? The kings love to lord their money over top of you. I mean, give to Caesar what Caesar's, right? So, but Jesus was not like that. He didn't have his image painted all over the place. I know that people think that there was a velvet picture of Jesus painted sometime, but it's not true. That was just Elvis. But after a meal, Jesus didn't give out autographs or anything like that. He gave himself. "This is my body that is going to be broken for you very, very shortly, within hours. This is my blood that's going to be shed for you." He gave himself out. And even though the disciples were arguing about who's going to be the greatest in the kingdom of heaven, he answered them with, "If you're like the youngest and you're like the servant, then you're going to be the most like me." See, our king's gift, the real king's gift, wasn't a token or a framed picture of himself sign saying, "You and me are boys, remember me with this." It was a gift of himself, way more than a token could ever be. That's the kind of gift that no ordinary king would give. A kind of gift that a king that is gracious from top to bottom would give. The kind of gift that a king would give that is filled with grace, that he would never fight fire with fire. From the moment he stepped on the scene and everywhere in between, he proved it over and over. And he certainly wouldn't give out a painting or anything superficial like that to remember him by, but he gave himself, his body, his blood. And that's how we're supposed to remember him. Now, when a king today is faced with something really difficult, and we're moving on to the prayer on Mount Olives, on the Mount of Olives, there's usually three things you'll hear. Some people call them the three D's: the deny, defer, and disassociate. It wasn't me. It's not my fault. No way, no how. I mean, really, I'm the king of the universe. These people are supposed to be serving me, right? I'm not supposed to be serving them. I mean, don't I have somebody that can do this job for me? Let somebody else do it. They can take care of it, because there is no way I am about to do this. But Jesus went to the Mount of Olives to pray. And even though he was overwhelmed with the task, even to the point where he was sweating blood, he still did not deny, he did not defer or disassociate himself with the fact that he was coming to save us all. He knelt down as the king of this universe and prayed, "Father, if you're willing, take this cup from me, but not as I will, but as you will. Let your will be done." An angel even came and strengthened him. And then he got up and went on, because he was no ordinary king. He was a gracious king. He didn't fight fire with fire, but he fought fire with grace. And from the second he stepped onto the scene to every single place in between, he proved it over and over. And he certainly would never get somebody else to do what only he could do. This morning's scripture is from Luke 23:32-43. Will you find that in your Bibles? And when you find it, please stand in honor of the reading of the word. Starting in verse 32, two other men, both criminals, were also led out with him to be executed. When they came to the place called the Skull, they crucified him there along with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they divided up his clothes by casting lots. The people stood watching, and the rulers even sneered at him. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them." Oh, I'm sorry, I skipped ahead. They said, "He saved others. Let him save himself, if he is God's Messiah, the chosen one." The soldiers also came up and mocked him. They offered him wine, vinegar, and said, "If you are the king of the Jews, save yourself." Verse 38, there was written notice above him which read, "This is the king of the Jews." One of the criminals who hung there beside him hurled insults at him. "Are you the Messiah? Save yourself. Save us." But the other criminal rebuked him. "Don't you fear God," he said, "since you are under the same sentence. We are punished justly for we are getting what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus answered him, "Truly, I tell you today, you'll be with me in paradise." This is the word of the Lord. You may be seated. I'm here this morning to tell you that an ordinary king would have never made it up that hill. At least not with about a bunch of kicking and screaming and whining. I mean, really, where was the entourage now? Where was the disciples at? They had abandoned. The religious leaders were sneering at him. "Like, I told you. I knew it. He wasn't the Savior." The women were upset and crying. And Jesus was mad, right? I mean, he couldn't believe that this stuff was happening after all he had done for them. This is how they repay him? By putting him between two sinners and crucifying him there. The very same people that he came to save were putting him on this cross. And I could just hear his anger as he says, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they were doing." It's not an ordinary reaction, because Jesus was not an ordinary king. He was a gracious king, and a king who would not fight fire with fire, even in the worst situations, even at the threat of death. He was gracious. From the moment he stepped onto the scene and every single place in between, even to death on a cross, he proved it over and over. Where there should have been anger and resentment, there was only grace and forgiveness. And if it wasn't bad enough to be nailed to the cross and struggling to breathe between two criminals, one of them has to heap insults on him. How nice is that? I'm sure he had some nice four-letter words to say and stuff like, "What the heck is wrong with you, Jesus, the Christ? Why don't you get us down from here? Save us, save me, save yourselves." But he was too busy insulting Jesus to recognize the unordinary king that hung next to him. And it was sacrificing himself for the people. I mean, he knew he needed to be saved. He just wasn't sure what he needed to be saved from. I kind of think that this is the guy on the left. And I get that from the sheep and goats parable. You know, Jesus had the goats on the left. Sorry, guys, on the left. And the sheep were on the right. So I kind of think that. But the other criminal got it. He understood that Jesus was innocent. We don't know this, but he probably, Jesus was a hit in Jerusalem. He probably saw some of the miracles. He certainly would have seen a huge difference in between the way Jesus acted and any other person that had ever lived acted while under the pains of certain death. It caused one person to hurl insults at him. It caused the other person, the guy on the right, it caused him to ask for grace. Even on the doorstep of death, Jesus proved one last time that he was no ordinary king. He was a gracious king, a king who would never fight fire with fire, but only fight fire with grace. The grace is available to everyone, even a criminal hanging on a cross. I looked up some of the Greek in there, and it wasn't just a one-time thing for these criminals. It was a lifetime of crime that they had been committing. Their entire lives were wrapped around crime and sin, and still Jesus forgave him and told him that he would be in paradise that day with him because he was a king who did not come to save himself. He came to save us. And it doesn't matter what you've done or how many times you've done it, how many times you've heard Jesus talking to you and how many times you've told him no. It doesn't matter if you're a thief, a liar, a criminal hanging on a cross. The grace of this extraordinary king is still for you and for me because he's willing to look past our lives, our former lives. We're all witnesses. We're all standing here giving our testimony that we're no longer the people that we were before we met Jesus. He's changed us from the inside out. It's a promise. We are brand new creations the second we say yes to Jesus. That's the only way the guy on the right is in paradise and in heaven. Jesus changed him. He was the advocate for him. He vouched for him. He's willing to look past everything we've ever done and step into the scenes of your life so that your life will never be the same again, ever. I know he doesn't look like a normal king. You know, he doesn't have anything flashy, no gold watch, no peeps, no security, no camel train, none of that stuff. But this morning, right here, 3135 Trenton Road, Grace Church of the Nazarene, he's just the kind of king we need. Amen. He's the kind of king we've been looking for your whole life. And saying yes to him is the best thing you can ever do. You will never be the same. You'll move from Jesus left to Jesus right. And you'll be with him forever in paradise. That's a promise. All you have to do is recognize who he is. Are you guys there this morning? Are you happy that you have a king that is extraordinary in all circumstances throughout his entire life? I know I am. But I also know there's probably people who haven't even given it a second thought. But I can tell you this morning, you're not here for no reason. This gospel, every time it's preached, I want to give you an opportunity to respond to it. Because Jesus wants to step into your scene no matter where you're at. And he can be yours. You can be his already. And maybe you've just walked a little bit away from him, kind of strayed from him. That's all right. He still climbed on the cross for that stuff too. And he wants to be there whether you got a British wig on, have an accent. He still wants to be the king of your heart this morning. So Bailey's going to come this morning, and she's going to sing a little bit. And I want to give you guys an opportunity to respond to the word that's given today. If you've got Jesus is calling out to you, and I know he is because I can feel it from here. I know he's calling out because he does his work. The altars are open. You know, respond if you feel led to. If you want to come up and pray for somebody that I mentioned earlier, then do that. But by all means, don't miss this opportunity to connect with this extraordinary king.